So when I said about migration, migration is something which has always happened. In the two pictures you see here, you see what the Italians were doing when they were coming to Ellis Island. I had some members of my family who went through this process. So there's nothing changed. This may happen all the time. It happens when you have specific conditions where which prevent citizens from carrying out their own easy life and progress and find welfare for their own families. So this is not a phenomenon which was generated because of the lack of capacity of politicians to act today or 10 years ago. This is an everlasting phenomenon, and we have to be able to live with it in all circumstances, because what comes from abroad can be an added value, and will, which has been very often an added value. Here you see the different rules of migration which Europe is facing with. It's amazing. It is a whole continent from Africa which is affected by this situation. You have a migration process from the east side, which was apparently was blocked because of the agreement which was taken by Europe and Turkey concerning the control of the borders and the control of the migrations and the refugee issues. We'll cover this in a minute, but I would like, if you allow me, just to give the word to Eleonora now, just for a few general considerations about this, because I think that Eleonora may wish to underline the issue about the identity, which really has a lot to deal with this migration issue. Thank you.
Yes. Can you hear me now?
Yes, you can.
You can, because the sound I'm getting from Vince is not brilliant, but I get it. Talk a little bit about how I see immigration in connection with the identity and integration issue. It seems to me that migration and migration policy are linked to the very nexus of issues which make integration of Europe either possible or impossible. It's at the very core of the idea of Europe. And what we take to be the migration crisis is to my mind, really the integration and the identity crisis of Europe. It seems to me that, let's say, the adolescence stage of Europe. It needs to find itself, and this integration, multiculturalism, lies at the very core of European values. So if we try to, if we think that a little bit, I heard about the history, and we see how Europe evolved, we will see that migration was always a part of it, and the past was not always a happy one. We had a lot of national struggle. The EU did not come easily or magically out of a vacuum. It evolved out of all this need to do away with this national conflict and to move away from the national-based organization to the citizenship-based organization with constitution, human rights at the base of it, and not common descent or language or things like that. So, If we directly link, for instance, migration with terrorism, even though there are practical issues there, we should be very careful to keep the issue separate, and we should be very, very, very careful to understand that the problem of migration that is currently faced in the EU, with all the reactions by the various member states and the political forces of Europe, is inextricably linked to the nexus of issues that make integration possible. Unless it's not, migration is not the problem for integration, but it throws the issues concerning integration into relief. It makes us understand both migration and integration problems, the integration process, because it seems that fear of migration is very linked, directly linked to fear of integration. We see a lot of the rhetoric in various member states at the moment, discussions about Brexit before Brexit now. We see that there is a fear of immigration from one country to the other, even within the European Union. But this is very important for the survival of the European Union, not to go back to renationalization. The European Union is a multicultural organization. It is, we hope, on the way to federalism. But if we renationalize European ideas, if we focus on the member states, on the national states, we are moving away from this idea that came in is not perfect yet, but it came for a reason. To avoid wars, to build cooperation, and is beginning, it was, and is, I think, beginning to blossom despite the hiccups.
Yes. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Eleonora. That's what I intended to hear, actually, because this is real test, a test for communicators, a test for rulers, a test on the fundamental issues on which Europe, the European Union has been built. The two specific crises have really hit very much the public opinion, and you can see basically, you can taste what is happening, for instance, in the south of the EU, in a specific countries which were directly, immediately affected by the huge waves of migrants. I can mention that in the last 2 weeks, there have been more than 15,000 migrants reaching the Italian coasts. You can understand what this means. It's really an enormous amount of people, of human beings, which deserve good treatment, human treatment. And they are coming from all over the north of Africa. They are coming from Egypt, stopping in Crete, and then coming back and getting another ship on during very adverse, on very adverse conditions, and reaching the coast. There is a problem of rescue. There is a problem of processing these people and understand who they are, identifying them, and see what their immediate needs are. And there is a process of follow up and find out exactly what will be a relocation, decent relocation solution for these people, and of course you have to process individual files, so to treat this case by case, so you can understand what potentially what enormous kind of efforts need to be made by the different national authorities and local authorities also, which are immediately invested by this this affected by this this phenomenon. So what is important also is just to make sure that there is some sort of a prompt intervention, that the citizens which are living in this area, our own citizens, see the public authorities immediately involved, immediately react. And also from our side, there is the capacity to detect immediately the public opinion trends, to understand what's going on, and what we can do to figure out what we can do to try to be as close as possible to the local populations, to make sure that they perceive us as a part of a global effort to find solutions to these problems. So what the European Union does from time to time is just to run some sort of a public opinion survey to detect the feelings of the population. And there are two general surveys which are run actually per year, where the citizens are asked to mention what they feel is a primary issues, which are topics which are directly affecting them, and they have can have a real big role to play in their own daily lives. And of course, the last one, which was performed at the end of 2015, identified migration and terrorism as the two top topics. We organized meetings among communicators to understand what degree of of strategic approach was taken by in each individual member states, and what was the ground for finding those kind of minimum denominators, basically common denominators, to understand if there is a way to do not create new strategies from scratch, but just to draw lessons from the existing communication strategies in one member state. And on this issue, I will involve Eric concentrate on the real issues which can be tackled by relatively minimum efforts. Meanwhile, of course, the press is playing its own role. The issues are covered by different type of media. The impact is the one you know, and what happened in the Greek borders when we started to see what was happening from Turkey during the migration waves at the very beginning of the year and the last at the end of the last year was really dramatic. I think it was really shaking people's conscience and let them understand that even if the problem was not necessarily close to their own borders, it was supposed to be perceived as a global problem. No one would be really so unsensible to understand that the problem is really, really big and it may have huge consequences. It looked like we were watching scenes from the World War time. I mean, it was inconceivable that this kind of phenomena would happen today in the Western world. And I think it was really a shocking moment, which induced the member states and their governments to meet more frequently and to focus on these kind of priorities. Again, the press, yes, the press can have a big impact on this because it can be as close as possible to the events and then give you pictures, show everything in its own gravity, but at the same time, the press has different type of views and the press is read everywhere. And the public opinion is, of course, influenced by the different views that the press is having. Here you've got three different way to deal with the issue, to show the issue, from three different Italian newspapers, which are of course representing different political views. And you can understand that what is missing here sometimes is just the view from the constructive angle. Because if you, before enlarging the process of the discussion, and having people express themselves freely to see how we can make progress. If you start from the point of view that you have to criticize the organization, the existing organizations, because the problems maybe were not solved 2 years ago, even if they were well identified, I mean, we don't go anywhere. From this kind of a perspective, we can only increasingly feed a bad feeling from in the public opinion. So you will understand how difficult it is for the rulers and for the communicators, which are going to be, as you know, we are supposed to be the link between the politics and the public opinion. You can understand how this can deeply affect our job, because then it brings another issue, time, urgency. I mean, how to cover these issues while social medias are developing the dialogue in all directions? Why? I mean, we have to double think about how to handle specific emergencies, but not only plunging into the social media context, but also being there on a regular basis and have the structure, the capacity to react, to continue to react, to have a continuous flow of information, but also interact, be ready to interact. So when we think about getting into a social media context, we need to understand that we need to be ready to continue to do it, not only just to create a nice web page or create our own Twitter account. That's the first step. What happens next is really the most difficult issue, because you have to be able to face with the enormous wave of demands from the public. Of course, Last year, as I said, I spoke about ethics. Looking at some images which happened at the Hungarian border a few months ago, that was really one of the saddest things that I could see, I mean, in my life. Because instead of fulfilling your role as a media representative, someone who should have in his DNA the mission to do well for people and to do well for human beings' emergencies, so you behave completely differently. This is really horrible, and I think that I believe that in general the member states representatives reacted very, very quickly, and also, I mean, in terms of ethics, I don't think that the actors, the players in these images had a big future afterwards. Okay. Yes. So, what shows, I mean, we need to be ready also as communicators to accept criticism and also understand that there are some paradoxes in what in which we have to swing. Sometimes some countries make it very easy to process refugee status or citizenship grant because of certain convenience. You see, this is something which we should also reflect on, because first, what comes first is just a human being as such, and second, what the human being is supposed to be bringing in terms of positive factors for a specific society. So we must not forget, that's what I would like to say, we must not forget the humanitarian side has to come first, it's clear, because we are in front of, first of all, of a humanitarian situation, crisis. And in this context, as I said, we are quite well mobilized within the Club of Venice. We recently organized two seminars on migration, where we invited the communicators from all the member states, also from the accession countries, those who are negotiating the entry into the EU, and the EU institutions, and also some external specialists.